Thank you. Whose coming we await, you invite us into the light of your presence. Illuminate the dim places of our hearts. We are thirsty for your compassion. Draw near to us and fill us, that we may pour out your goodness to all those who hunger. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry and we sinned, because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity. Now consider, we are all your people. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Advent is that time of year when we remember that we live in the now and not yet of God's coming. And Rowan Williams' poem resonates for me this year in a particularly special way because several of my siblings have welcomed new arrivals to our family. Yes, some of you have heard me gushing and endured the many pictures that I have been bandying about. Two new nephews have arrived these past 2 months, and another child this week, I learned, it's my second niece. She is on the way, and yet, not yet left. We are waiting. She is overdue. But when I got to see the first of these three precious little children, I got to go 10 days after his long-awaited advent. We hadn't been popping calendar windows necessarily, counting down the days, but there were many texts flying about with a kind of similar function, giving us tiny little glimpses into the activities of my brother and his wife as they spent the better part of that week attending to the signs. Was it time to go to the hospital? Yes, let's go. No, let's go back home. It's not time. And finally, after long last, Henry Ames was born. That first weekend, I drove to Dixon, getting a chance to finally meet this long-awaited little one. I sat up late that first night talking with my brother. My sister-in-law had gone to sleep. She very much deserved that rest after having coached the midwife, the doctor, and her husband on how to help her birth this child. She is a physics person, and she understood how the mechanics were working in that moment. So she was fast asleep. Henry was wide awake, definitely preferring that we walk him around the room, no sitting down on his watch. And like any newborn, he was so tiny and tender, though he was almost 10 pounds, he still looked petite, nestled in those muscular arms of his father, my brother, the Air Force pilot, something you've seen. He's a big fellow. So this slumbering infant evoked for me these symbolic shoots of the fig tree that we heard about in the Gospel of Mark. Yes, it was Mark, not Matthew. That was a typo. There was this new life leafing out in trusting possibilities, and just like our reading imagines it, these are the tender moments that we hold on for in the midst of all that swirls around us. Glimmers of hope, where and when we least expect, breaking our hearts wide open with love's magnificence. Yes, God is very near, and we feel that when we hold a baby, don't we? Our hearts aligning with that steady beat of another, heavy head resting against our chest. I don't know about you, but I can't stay armored up when I'm holding a little one. And keeping awake in the middle of the night is something we dare to do, know how much it matters, no matter how strongly the tug of sleep pulls at our eyelids. We listen with all our senses to perceive the needs of the little one who needs to be contented, who needs to feel safe in order to grow into the fullness of human potential. Advent is not only the time that we remember all these warm fuzzies, the presence of the God who entered history and came into the world as that babe born in Bethlehem. It is a season for more than merely opening those daily windows on the cosmic calendar as we seek and pursue reassurances of hope and healing to counter the pain and frustration of our world. It is also a time of preparation that asks us to be honest as we examine the many ways we are prone to falling asleep. Isn't it easy to get distracted, maybe even lulled into that semi-hypnotized state amid the frenzy of the holidays? In that place, we can sometimes miss the moments where life asks us to notice what is true, what is real, what is wrong. We live in the now and not yet of God's coming. And so Mark's keep awake mantra echoes those many parables we've been living with this past fall as we've been encountering the stories from Matthew's gospel. All of these reminding us how prone to forgetting we humans can be. Though Though grace keeps turning up at our door with humbling simplicity and sometimes little fanfare, asking us to open our hearts to the divine presence. God comes into the world seeking a home with us. And we have lots of choices about how we tend the gates of our hearts, whether or not we will remove all that stands in the way of our receiving that disarming gift of such a transforming presence. So I've been thinking a bit about spiritual practices that we take up in order to prepare for God's coming. Yesterday, that looked different as we gathered in Grace Cathedral and voted on our new bishop for the Diocese of California. I saw people with their own personal ways of keeping watch in prayerfulness and hopefulness. And it got me thinking to the practices that we do here in our community, the practices that we do individually in our households and in our families and in our daily lives. How do we make room to listen and to align with those divine rhythms that insist, steady as any heartbeat, that love is here, asking us to risk, to receive, to respond? For just as Christ came into the world where very few were hospitably inclined to him, so Christ will come again at the fullness of time to judge and to redeem the world. Will he find our hearts ready to receive him? There's a lot of interplay with light and darkness in the season of Advent, and we will hear more of that in our prayers in the weeks to come. Friedrich Buechner, who died last year, has reflected a lot on Advent and how this season invites us to notice something he calls the invasion of the holy in our lives. I want us to spend a minute thinking about this, given that there's a lot of more violent imagery around invasion in the world at the moment, but this incursion of the holy, this subtle invitation that love is here and on the way, feels helpful to me in this moment when I look around and notice how there are the mighty, powerful forces, death, destruction, assailing many men, women, and yes, infants in places all around the world, perhaps most especially in war-torn parts of the globe. And the fragility of that global peace these past few weeks has been lingering in my mind as I notice the warm glow of our seasonal celebrations, one of which was the lighting of the tree in Burlingame on Friday night. So as we pray with this imagery of light and darkness in Advent, noticing that they ask us to pay attention, I want us to encounter the wisdom that Buechner offers up. He says, those prayers that tell us to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light are words that name the paradox of who and what we are, somewhere between the darkness and the light. He says this is not only what we are in Advent time, but at all times as Christians. As people of faith, we attune ourselves to the truth that somewhere between the fact of darkness and the hope of light, we are here in the waiting, looking with hope toward the coming of the light of the world, Jesus Christ. That is a comfort, Buechner says, but the challenge of it is that that light also has not yet come. Only the hope for it, the longing. In the meanwhile, he says, we are in the dark, and the dark, God knows, is also in us. We watch and wait for holiness to enter, to invade when we least expect it, to heal and hallow us, liberating us from the dark. Perhaps like that theater curtain just before it rises, or the hazy ring around a winter moon that signals the coming of snow will soon turn the night to silver. But for this time, in this moment, darkness is where we are. Holding this imagery in contrast with the shoots that new life in the fig tree, I've been thinking how easy it is to sometimes get confused, thinking it's my job to bring the light, that we are people who are full of new life and we're supposed to shine that forth in ways that are compelling. But the truth is, Advent brings us back into our appropriate place in the ecosystem, reminding us that it is God who brings this light. Christ, the one who enlightens us all with his Advent. And our task, our sacred call in this season and in all the days of our life is to commit ourselves to keeping awake. Maybe it's a little bit like sitting up late at night, holding an infant, quieting them to sleep, propping open our eyelids with toothpicks when we must. Whatever it takes to attune our hearts to the light of love's presence, the gift for which we long and wait with impatience. Yes, Advent is a time to open our hearts to God's coming. And maybe you have personal habits of contemplative prayer, and this year might be a good time to give yourself to some kind of daily practice. Maybe you're the type that finds it a little more reassuring to acknowledge the dark when you're in the company of others. And you can do that this evening at 4 o'clock, your Advent lessons and carols, or come back on Wednesday at 7 and be part of that waiting together in our new Blue Christmas service. Both are hopeful pathways to wait for love's light to dawn. And if you're the kind that likes to ground yourself in an outward expression of practical love as a prayerful practice, there's still a few tags on the giving tree you can select, praying by name for those people that you will lovingly select and choose and prepare gifts to be an expression of this grace in this season. However you decide, I pray you will take up some concrete practice by which you will say yes to this challenge to keep awake, that we all might respond faithfully when love comes. For God is always very near. Saving grace surely is on its way to judge and to redeem our world. How will we watch and make ready? As we are able, let us confess the mystery of our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. time of trouble, especially those affected by the violence in Israel and Palestine.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we remember the Church of North India. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Mark, our bishop, and Austin, our bishop-elect, and for all ministers of the gospel. For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, especially for all who serve as acolytes, as they lead the way in worship with the cross and candles, where their feet find a joyful pace, their arms and hands bring steadiness and strength, and their hearts beat with the gentle rhythms of your love. Help us grow in confidence and joy, and share your prayers enliven us all to follow Jesus. We pray for all who have died, especially Rosalind Carter, Henry Kissinger, and Sandra Day O'Connor, that they each may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Put their trust in you.
Let us join together in saying our prayer for mission.
Gracious and loving God, help us this day to understand and celebrate your dream for the world, to be transformed in Jesus' love, and to use our gifts to make a difference for others. Amen.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins.
Have mercy on us.
Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God of mercy, who forgives all our sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. As God has greeted us with Christ's peace, so let us share divine peace with one another. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Joined St. Paul's almost 20 years ago. We moved from the city to Burlingame, and and we felt immediately welcome here. St. Paul's gave our daughter Ella a community of friends and a foundation for faith. It also gave us opportunities to help families in need and to support a fellow parishioner. St. Paul's continues to remind me of my many blessings and how God wants me to be in the world. This year's pledge theme is Traditions, Blessings, and Possibilities. I want to extend a huge thank you to all of you out there who have already pledged. It makes such a big difference in budget planning for 2024. For those following our progress, you can see over there, the pledges that are now at 82% of goal, with 73% of households participating as of Thursday, which is fantastic. Again, thank you. And if you haven't pledged and want to, there are pledge cards in the back of the church, or you can pledge online at St. Paul's website. Thank you.
Thank you, Serena.
I'm Tish Bissell, and as Reverend Sarah said this morning, St. Paul's Advent Giving Tree continues, but this is the last day to select gift cards, gift tags, or food tags from the tree in the parish hall. Everything is due next Sunday. A little bit of grace beyond that to bring things to the office. What we really need, besides people taking gift tags or food tags, is people who will help on Sunday, December 17th at 9 a.m. in the morning for wrapping and food sorting, and or for gathering at 11:30, spending at most 30 minutes delivering to one of the five families that we're helping this year. So thank you all very, very much. St. Paul's Advent Giving Tree lives once again to help others in need.
Thank you. As I mentioned, we did in fact elect a new bishop, and that bishop-elect, Kevin Jeter, will come alongside Bishop Mark at the beginning of the year and spend the next 6 months before Mark's retirement in June, getting to know the context. And it's a good thing that he has that time, because he's coming all the way from Rome. Austin K. Rios is presently serving as the rector of St. Paul's in the Walls, as they call it, the Episcopal congregation that is in that interfaith location there in Jerusalem. So they run a refugee center, they have all kinds of different ministries, interfaith ministries, and so there'll be a lot of wisdom and connectivity to the needs of the world that Austin brings among us. His wife, Malia, and their daughter will be in the process of moving, and having done that recently myself, and they come a lot further than I did, I'm going to be praying for them, and I invite you to do the same. We have no longer the embedded prayer that was really lengthy that we've been praying for months and months, but you too can pray for these individuals as they prepare to come among us and to learn about us and to bring their ideas and gifts to bear as we forge a new path forward together. It's not like they get to do all the work, it's we join them in entering into this new season of our public witness, saying, what does love call us to do and to be in this time and place with the resources entrusted to us? So I know each and every one of you live that question in your daily lives and your circle of influence. So this is an exciting new beginning as we prepare for that time of embarking together with a new Episcopal leader. There are many ways in which you can journey through Advent. There are a lot of details in our announcement sheet. I'm going to encourage you to read those. I know the Spiritual Journeying Group has a group today in Higley Library immediately after the service, and they would welcome you to take a step if today you're feeling moved to enter into the season. But there are lots of ways. When I name some of them in my sermon, I know there are folks who would be delighted to have you come and be part of this community at a deeper level. So if this is your first time visiting, welcome. I'm Sarah, the rector. I'd love to chat with you after the service, learn a little more about you, your family, your longings for spiritual nurture in this season, and to support you in finding where you are called to grow in your faith in this time. If you have not been part of our communion experience before, the ushers will invite you forward and you'll kneel, filling in from the center to the side, and you're welcome to receive bread. There are gluten-free wafers if you need that. Just let us know as we're distributing. There's real communion wine in the cup, and you're welcome to receive. Just help guide the chalice to your mouth by holding the bottom and letting the person know kind of where it is in relation to your lips. And if you don't prefer to take a drink from the cup, you can cross your arms over your chest, receive a prayer and blessing. There's no wrong way to do it. Everyone is warmly welcome to receive this grace and love that we know in this meal that Jesus came to offer as a symbol of his love for the world. So please know that you are warmly welcome. As we turn our hearts toward the table, then, let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice for the whole world.
Thank you. Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory,
have not been for a long time, you who have tried to follow Jesus, and you who have failed, come, because it is Christ who invites us to meet God here.
Thank you.
and of Jesus Christ, who summons us to service, and of the Holy Spirit, who inspires generosity and love, be with us all evermore.